Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Hi,
Hi.
Kathy.
There's Melanie, Chicharita. How are you all doing? Nandini, Lisa. Thank you, Amy, Dara. Thank you for joining us today. It's our first webinar of the year
For
for
the new year.
SoHum.
It's
Yes.
exciting.
So thank you so much for joining. So we have a really exciting topic and guest today. We are going to be talking about intentional living. Now, before we get started, why don't you just let us know where you're dialing in from? So that way we can see all the exciting places where you're dialing from. And if you feel like it, we welcome you to turn your cameras on so that way we can see your beautiful faces. Thank you. Nice. We're here in family, so it's all good. Nice.
Hi, Lisa. Hi, Gina.
So nice to see so many faces that have actually followed us all through last year and then again this year. So we'll give everyone a few minutes just to dial in. In the meantime, please feel free to type in there where you're dialing from. So that way we can see. I know we have some people from Asheville. Let's see. Yes,
Nice.
Asheville. Great to see you, Amy. Savannah, Georgia. Boston, how's the weather up
I
there?
know, I was going to say.
Yeah, we cannot complain of cold weather here, can we? Nice. Very cold. Yeah.
Ooh, Florida. Nice, Lisa.
Canada, Toronto, Connecticut, Asheville. Yeah. I'm sure you're having a beautiful weather up in Florida. Well, thank you so very much for joining. Once again, I'm Sandy. I am your Ayurvedic ambassador for SoHum Mountain Healing Resort. And today I'm here with Sneha. And Sneha, probably most of you have seen her some way, somehow, through some of our different webinars. She's not only our Ayurvedic, senior Ayurvedic practitioner, but she's also the dean for our Ayurvedic Institute. And she works hand in hand with Dr. Ladd day in and day out. So thank you so
Oh.
much for joining us today on our very first webinar for the year at SoHum.
It's a pleasure.
Yeah. And today we're going to be talking about intentional living. Now, what does that mean, right? It's like at the beginning of the year, everyone is like setting up the intention for the year. Everyone is thinking about what is going to be my New Year's resolution. If you did that, raise your hand and tell me that you set up your New Year's resolution. Maybe you didn't.
Or even just an intention for the
Or the
year.
intention. There you go. So most of us go into the new year with this new energy, this new, mentality of what is it that I want to set for the year. Now, we have Sneha here because we really want to dive deeper into what does that mean? What does it mean to set the intention? What does it mean? Because sometimes we begin, but then by the second week, we are already like, oh, I cannot keep it up. So Sneha today is going to talk to us about how to actually set up that intention, how to live intentionally every day, how to create good habits. So within those habits, they can become a lifestyle change for the rest of our life, not just for a period of time. And then also, what are some of the really good, easy peasy practices from an Ayurvedic perspective that we can just keep doing every day to help us feel better? So let's just begin with, what does intentional living mean, Sneha? Why don't you just tell us, what does that mean?
Like everything, right? But I mean, I think it's different for each person, but really it's understanding, what is it that I want in my life? Like, where do I want to be? Who do I want to be? Right? If I understand those things, and it could be as simple as like, what value do I want to live by every day? And then can I have that intention of living by that value every day? Mm. It, what I realize, especially through Ayurveda, is the simpler it is, the better and more doable, mm. right? Because the more complex we make things, which life is already complex for us, and I add even more complexity by adding this type of intention, that type of intention, 15 other things, I'm not going to do any of those things.
So true.
So I just realized it's more about getting back into our heart, really understanding, like, what is it that I need for my being? What's that one thing or two things maximum? Mm-hmm. And then we set around that intention to really understand. And it's about understanding ourselves, right? Mm-hmm. Having that self-awareness within ourselves.
So beautiful. Yeah. So beautiful. And you said it very well. Like sometimes we just create this almost like a to-do list.
Yeah.
Like all the things yeah. I want to achieve this year. And it, right there and then sometimes it just becomes unachievable, right?
It's not
and
a grocery list.
So true. But I love the fact that you're saying the simplicity. Yeah. And I also absolutely love the fact that you're saying, what do I want to be? What do I want to do? Like right. kind of like going in that introspect and really analyzing and then going from there, as yes. opposed to just saying, I want to lose weight. I want to go to the gym. I want to eat healthier. That's I want right. to just like really from my heart.
Yeah.
Now, from that point forward, now, if any of you have set an intention already for the year and you feel like you want to share it, feel free to put it on the chat. We're open to have that discussion with you. If you maybe set that this intention yeah. for prior years and for some reason you were not able to get through it and you would like some advice from Sneha as to how you can make it more achievable, please feel free to put it in there. Let's have a discussion. Let's have a conversation over this, okay?
And it can be inspiring to all of us.
Exactly.
Right? Because we're all learning together. There is no real right or wrong when it comes to this. Yeah. It's more about just understanding where I am, where do I want to go, and how do I fill that gap in there?
It's so true. So true. Perfect.
Oh.
All right.
I love that.
Rising with the sun. Wow.
That's beautiful, Kathy.
That is. Yeah.
Right. The rhythms of nature
right.
and really sinking in with the rhythms of nature. I love that.
Mm-hmm. And maybe you can talk to us about the seasons mm-hmm. and how to connect with our circadian rhythm. Any other ones here?
Evelyn just said to remain guided and open to discernment and enlightenment.
Wow. That is beautiful, Evelyn.
Yep.
Be loving to my family. Lisa, truly taking care of myself, mm-hmm. self-love, self-healing, yep. self-care is a beautiful topic. And actually, we're going to be talking about that all throughout the month of February as well. So I love that you brought that up, Lisa, because sometimes, I mean, when we wake up in the morning, when we see our family, when we go yep. out, when we go to work, when we see people on the streets, we say hi with yes. so much love and passion to yeah. everyone. We give everyone hugs and kisses. But when do we give ourselves a hug?
Yeah.
When do we give ourselves beautiful words in front of the mirror, right? I love that. So my intention is to become a student of the Ayurvedic Institute.
Yay!
Oh, nice. Well, let's make that happen. Absolutely. Being outdoors more, not being so down on myself. That was Amy. Well, thank you for the vulnerability. Yeah. Thank you for opening up, because that's when we really, what Sneha yeah. was saying, like going deep in and realizing what are the things that are working for me, the things that are not, and how can I actually work through it? So now let's talk about from an Ayurvedic perspective. Somebody brought up the seasons and yes. intentionality.
Yeah.
So Sneha, why don't you just tell us a little bit about how important the seasons are, that change, that transition, yeah. and how can we embed that into our intention?
No, it's beautiful. I think it was Kathy that said it, right? Rising with the sun. Mm-hmm. There's seasonality in everything we do. We think of the seasons as a traditional season, like fall or autumn, then winter, then spring, then summer, those kind of things. But there's seasons within our lives. There's seasons within the day, right? These are all different things that are transitions. If I can understand what those transitions are, when they're happening, then I can just start flowing with it. Because you know how many people sometimes it's like you're doing something and you feel like you're just going upstream constantly. You're like, I need some wind in my sails, or I want to just coast for a little bit, right? Sometimes that upstream and like heavy pushing that we're always doing, sometimes it could be just adjusting to like what is happening seasonally. And seasonally, like I said, I'm using it as a broad thing, but like during the day, right? There's different times and transitions. Am I in sync with those? During the week, during the actual season, during the year, am I in sync with these things? And if I just make small little tweaks just from awareness of what's happening, I can see how much easier it is for my being to just kind of flow in and not feel like I'm always just pushing up, 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 up kind of thing.
Yeah. And you just brought up such a level of awareness to the fact, and I don't know how many of you, but when we think seasons, absolutely. We think, you know, the fall, the winter, the summer, the spring. But you just brought up so much awareness to the fact that there is many other different type of seasons.
Yeah.
It's like for women.
That's right.
We have the seasons when, you know, we are actually first getting our menstrual cycle. Then we continue to evolve. Maybe when we are getting ready to become a mother, that's the season. Then when we have our children, then when our children leave the home, that is the season for us mentally, emotionally, as well as physically, right? So maybe all of us can actually go into that practice that you just offer us and think about seasonally, not just, you know, fall, winter, et cetera.
Yeah.
But seasonally, where are we? Where are we at this point in time of our life? And let's just take a pause right there for 1 second and analyze. Just maybe if you want, you can even close your eyes and see in what type of season am I in my life? You know, maybe we're going through some difficulties at home. Maybe it's separation from something or work related, or that is a season too. So see, or maybe you're having festivities. Maybe you're having so much joy in your life. Maybe you're becoming a grandparent.
Yeah.
That is so much joy coming into your life. So just take a look and sink, let that sink in for a second and see in what type of season are you going through?
That's right.
And then we're going to bring that intentionality that Sneha has been talking about. Like, okay, based on that season, where do I want to be?
Yeah.
Where do I want my life to go this year? Because by putting these things together, then it's going to allow us to make those decisions about what actions we need to take in order to continue evolving this year, right? So take your time. You can write it down. You can just let it sink in. You can breathe it in, breathe it out, and we'll continue here. Because all this is for you to be able to set that intention for the year that actually becomes something that you can accomplish. So now that we talked about the seasons and we talked about the intention, so what are some of the tips that you can recommend that we can do as we're trying to get healthier and become a better person? Now, usually we correlate having a better year with our health, which is a beautiful thing.
Yes.
But there is also the mental.
That's right.
The physical and also the spiritual health.
Yes.
So can you talk about all three and how they actually become an essential part of our being?
Definitely. You know, it's so funny because even today in lecture this morning, right, being at the Institute and we were with the students, and we were talking about this concept of AMA, right? AMA, which we call, it's translates into simply like toxins, toxins that are within our body. We think of toxins when we're eating something. Like if I didn't eat something right, I didn't eat, I overate, right? It can cause like indigestion and toxins. We think physically. But one of the key things is actually the mental toxins that can build up. The same AMA that can build up because I ate something wrong in my body is the same AMA that can build up because of mental toxins. At the end of the day, we're all just energy, right? At some form of energy, whether it's the food I'm consuming, the thoughts that I'm thinking, or the sensory input that's coming into me. If I'm seeing something beautiful, I'm listening to something playful, whatever it may be. If I don't process those items, I don't let that energy continually keep moving, then it creates a stagnation. It creates a blockage in myself. Then that blockage can affect so many different aspects of my being. Like you're saying, it can affect me physically, right? And that's when we're like, oh, my knee hurts, my back hurts, right? Mm-hmm. Or my digestion's off, or my bowel movements are off. It can affect me mentally. I can have just anger and sadness or irritation and frustration. And you're just like, why am I irritated all day long? And there's no reason to be irritated. You're not even around anyone. You're just walking in the park and you're like, I'm irritated, yes. Right? I mean, we've all been there. Or tense or stress. And you're like, where's this coming from, right? Mm-hmm. There's a stagnation. There's a not letting go. There's a not flow that's happening. Does that make sense?
That makes so much sense. So making sure that then all the input is, so it's not only the food, it's how we actually process and digest.
That's right.
Every single input, it could be any sensory, right? What we
anything.
Watch.
Yes.
I mean, we spend so much time on our phones or even the TV shows that we select to watch. So maybe we can bring that intentionality that you were talking about earlier.
That's right.
About what are the things that I'm going to allow into my life, whether it's through the audio, through the smell, through the visual, because all that is going to impact. Now, you do talk a lot about the emotions and the organs.
Yes.
And if we're not able to process everything that we're exposed to, then that is gets stagnated into the organs. Can you briefly talk about that and how that affects our health and our organs?
Definitely. And I think everyone can relate to this, whether we've consciously thought about this or not. Like as I was learning, right, when I first started learning Ayurveda, I was like, oh, this totally makes sense. Like I've experienced it. I just never knew what I was experiencing. Right. But when we have these emotions, let's say an emotion of sadness, or grief, right? Someone maybe has passed away or a loss has happened or a separation of some sort has happened. And we feel that. What do we say? Like even just naturally, we would say, oh, I'm feeling a little sad today. Where does my hand naturally go, right? Mm-hmm. It goes to the heart. That's where sadness and grief has an affinity to the heart and the lungs area. And when we don't have that, how many people have experienced where all of a sudden, right, our immunity goes down a little bit. We start feeling a little cold, a little cough, a little congestion, a little heaviness, a little bit harder to breathe, right? Now it's starting to manifest physically. Initially, it's the emotional, mental side. We're like, yeah, I can feel something's off, right? Like this heaviness. But then it starts manifesting physically because it's still there. It hasn't moved away. And I see some people nodding their head like, yes, we've all been there. Mm-hmm. And this is like, it's like common sense Ayurveda, which we don't share in this world, right? It's so simple. Ayurveda and living Ayurveda can be so simple with just a little bit of awareness into our being.
Beautiful.
Or anger, right? Anger, frustration, irritation, or criticism, all these type of little like hot things. Like what happens when we get angry? We get hot, right? We get red. Sometimes our palms will start sweating. Our body's trying to release that heat. Well, maybe our armpits start sweating, right? The liver is the organ of heat. It is the organ of pitta dosha, which is associated with anger and irritation. So then again, physically, we'll start getting some liver issues, manifestations, and like the filtration that the liver needs to do, the processing, it starts getting glitchy. And then we start seeing like rashes start happening or breakouts happening, you know, different things that the liver really helps to support. So this is how it goes from like, you're just thinking, oh, I just had a bad argument with Sandy for a minute. Who cares? Blow it off. No, we're going to think about it, whatever. But then 2 weeks later, you're like, you start feeling it. And you're like, why am I so angry? What the heck's going on, right? It's this piece that we don't realize subconsciously, unconsciously, we're holding on to this stuff. And it just causes that stagnation.
Wow. So all of you now can see how we're connecting the dots on that intentionality. From the seasons to the emotions to the body and the mental and the spiritual. So if you have any emotions that you want to work on this year, I mean, just putting it out there to the universe. Yeah. If you want, you can type it on the chat. You know, feel free. We can discuss it if you want. If you want, you can just write it down for yourself. But any emotions that you're feeling, do write it down and see. And maybe you can go deeper into that emotion and analyze, like, where is it coming from? Is it coming from this life? It could be coming from past life, right? Why am I feeling like, what is that person triggering in me? How can I work through it? So that way, as you can see, our intention for the year, it does not have to be like year after year, let's go to the gym, let's do this.
Exactly.
But it could just simply be like, I need to be more compassionate. Mm-hmm. Or perhaps, you know, with my husband, I need to be more patient. You know, things like that. Like, how do we get into this habit of learning more about our own self so that way we can set the proper intention that is ultimately going to allow us to be a better human being for ourselves, but more importantly, also for others, for anyone that we interact with. So do you have any tips on actually how to kind of like sense when the emotions are happening and how to regulate?
Yes.
Because self-regulation is something that takes practice. So why don't you just tell us, like, what kind of tips do you have?
The easiest tip I'll tell you that I even do for myself is breath. Mm-hmm. Start paying attention to your breath, because the breath will control our thoughts, or our thoughts will control our breath. It can be either way. But if I start getting an awareness into my breath, and we can go through a little exercise together.
Let's do it.
So when we're thinking, and it could be anything, whatever that emotion it is that you're trying to remove, right? Or just think when you felt that emotion, whether it's sadness, whether it's anger, whatever it may be, right? Think, what's happening to my breath in that moment? Usually it's hard to take like a deep, long breath. Usually we start breathing shallow. We're up here in this upper lung area.
Mm-hmm.
So next time that you feel any of these emotions, watch your breath first and foremost, and then consciously bring awareness to the breath and just take simply 3 to 5 deep breaths first, right? And very conscious. And they can be loud too, in the sense that, you know, like Darth Vader, I love Star Wars. So like that Darth Vader breath, Ujjayi breath, it can be just, right? What do we tell someone when we're with a friend and they're going through something? What do we say? Like, we put our hand on their back and we say, it's okay. Here, just take a deep breath, right? And when we do release something, what do? We sigh it out. We're like, right? Same thing. Do that consciously. Do it very deliberately, just taking a deep breath in and then release it out.
Great job, Evelyn.
I saw that.
What are you doing?
Yes. Beautiful. Nice. Beautiful. This, believe it or not, as simple as this sounds, because this, you don't need any tools. You can be anywhere and do this, right? You can do it in privacy. You can do it as a group. We do pranayama sometimes together as a group, right?
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter. You don't need anything. You just need that awareness for that moment. And then you do this deliberately. It starts actually changing our neurochemistry within our body, believe it or not. It mm-hmm. starts releasing different chemicals in our brain, in our gut. It starts to rewire us and rebalance everything within our being.
So powerful, so powerful, because that means then we now have the power, the key in
That's
our
right.
hands as to how to control and actually how to navigate through those situations that may be difficult. I mean, we're souls going through this human experience, right?
Yes.
And it takes time for us to get into it. So that practice of getting into the breath. Another one that I actually do is I feel my body. I try to feel my body. And I feel like whenever I'm in a situation where I feel contraction, I actually intentionally think about, am I feeling contraction or expansion?
Beautiful.
And for me, expansion is that moment when your heart opens, where you're feeling joy, where you're feeling openness, when you're willing to receive. But the moments that I feel contraction, you can almost even see your body. Like, you just go like, almost like you're in pain. You may not be in physical pain, but your body's like, I am feeling this heaviness on my back.
That's right.
So the moment that you do that breath, it's just like Evelyn was doing.
Mm-hmm.
You're effectively letting go. So again, for this year, just being more intentional about what we consume, what we hear, what we talk, what we say with our word, how we feel, right? It's a beautiful thing.
And I'll give one more little tip.
Yeah, please.
And just because some of us are more kinesthetic, right? We want to be more physical and in the body, like what you're saying,
mm-hmm.
is simply, I call it like a lymphatic or motion tapping. So that could be anywhere. Okay. So our lymph is all through our body, and our lymph really helps us to kind of decongest and filter stuff out of our system. And it can get stagnated also when we start feeling this constriction that you're saying. Mm-hmm. It's really simple. Just cup your hands, and I'll show you this sideways, right? So it's not flat, because if it's flat, it's like you're smacking yourself. You don't want that. This is like a nice gentle pat on yourself. Mm-hmm. Exactly. Good job. You're taking it and you are patting yourself, right? This is starting to create motion and looseness and like loosening up everything and go everywhere. And those areas that you're feeling a little bit more soreness, like if you have a little low back pain or hip pain or shoulder and neck pain, spend a little extra time in those areas. You start doing this on a daily basis, I promise you, you will start noticing a difference in this, because you are creating motion. You're forcing that stagnation to start breaking up and moving around and circulating and getting it out of your being.
Nice. I've never tried that one. It's now that's really been an intention for me. I'm going to start doing that one too. Nice. Yeah. Thank you for sharing
of
that.
Of course.
One. And I see a comment here from Evelyn. She says that she feels stuckness in her throat, mm-hmm. and then coughing first thing in the morning. Mm-hmm. So what would you recommend for that?
Yeah, so that's a lot of that mucus or kapha, right, that's coming up too. So simple, again, simple remedy. I'm all about just keeping it simple, because then it's doable. Salt water with a little turmeric. So get about a half a cup or a cup of warm water in the morning. Salt, and you mix it in there so it dilutes in there, and then a half a teaspoon to a teaspoon of turmeric powder, because salt and turmeric, right, they're fantastic from like killing the viruses and all these kind of things and loosening things up. So you'll even notice that some of it will come a little bit more, Evelyn, which you want out of your system. And then from an herbal standpoint, which is a really nice one also, there's two really nice herbs that are available. I usually end up ordering a lot of stuff from Banyan Botanicals. So you can get them in like small little sizes too, if you want to. It's called Sito Paladi and Thali Sadi. It's Sitopaladi, Sito Paladi. And then Thali Sadi, which is Talisadi. So these are a decongestant and an expectorant. So it's going to decongest, like if you've got a lot of stuckness, especially happening, whether it's in the throat or in the upper lungs, lung area, it'll start loosening it up, and then it'll start it to come out. Mm-hmm. You can just take a quarter teaspoon of each, mix them. They're powders. They taste yummy. Okay. This is one of those herbs where it's not like bitter and you're like, oh, what did she tell me to do? This actually tastes really good. And then put maybe like a couple of teaspoons of honey, mix it, and it makes like a little paste, and then just lick the paste. And you can do that 2 to 3 times a day. It has like a sweetness with a little heat on it too. Mm. Loosens everything up, and you'll notice it'll start coming out a little bit more too.
Okay. Just a quick question. For the salt and turmeric, is that something I drink or gargle with?
Gargle. Thank you, Evelyn. Gargle that. Yes. And Himalayan pink salt is fantastic also. That is fantastic to use.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Now, there is the herbal, the body, there is also the energy.
That's right.
Right? Yeah. And within the body, we have these vortexes or energy centers, right? They're called the chakras. And we all know that there is like the 7 chakras, which are the well-known. However, there is more than the 7.
Yes.
Actually, even outside of the body. But the ones that we know for the sake of this is the 7 chakras, right? And for you, Evelyn, that you were talking about the throat, it's also looking at where those energy centers are within the body. And what governs the throat and actually the thyroid is the throat chakra.
Yes.
So making sure, and I saw you doing that breath work that Sneha was sharing with us when you were going actually with your arms, then you feel free. You can open up your arms to actually open the chest, open the throat, and even exaggerate a little bit if you can. And then when you're letting go, just open your mouth, let your tongue out, and it's just like a tiger breath, right?
Yeah.
Yes. Beautiful. And at that way, you're just letting it all go, because sometimes, especially women, actually,
that's right,
we tend to actually not express ourselves.
Yes.
And one of the most beautiful things when we are actually connecting at the energetic level is being able to speak our truth. And the fact that we're speaking our truth, it doesn't have to be something that hurts anyone else.
No.
It can be very sensitive. It can be very emotional. But we speak from a place of love,
mm-hmm,
because we're connecting that throat chakra with the heart chakra. So making sure that we're actually speaking our truth, that we're able to communicate. Also, when we have challenges with that area, it could be that we're not able to listen.
Mm-hmm.
So communication is about giving and receiving.
Yeah.
It's about talking and also listening. So maybe working through that area. And Sneha was talking about the correlation of the organs and the emotions.
Mm-hmm.
And all the emotions and the chakras are directly correlated to an area that is being governed by that chakra. So making sure that we're working through any stagnated energy within the chakras as well. And do you 100%. Have any tips on how to work any of the other chakras to make sure that we're not stagnating the energy within the chakras?
No, I think you said it really beautifully too, Sandy. It's all the chakras, right? Those seven major chakras are like right kind of aligned right in the center of our body.
Mm-hmm.
So it could be as simple as this breathwork stuff, bringing that attention into it, or even in the tapping. You could even make your hands like almost like this little pointed where all five fingers are touching. And then you can touch each of the chakras, right? Mm-hmm. Or even just tap all the way along the center core. And you're just tapping along the center and just taking it.
Beautiful.
So that way you are getting straight into every chakra. I won't tap too close to the microphone so it doesn't blow anyone's ears. But you are tapping along that center, right? You're just awakening. And what I loved what you said, Sandy, is talking,
mm-hmm,
right? Expression. But what is that at the end of the day? It's movement.
Mm-hmm.
I'm expressing and I'm moving stuff. I'm moving energy. I'm expelling, I'm exhaling, inhaling when I'm talking. It's movement. So that's why expression is so important as well.
Mm-hmm. Nice. All right. So we have delivered a lot already with different techniques and different tips on what you can use to set your intention. Now, let's talk about how do we actually begin to execute the intentions in a way that becomes sustainable?
Yeah.
Because sometimes that is the biggest challenge, right? I mean, myself included,
oh, yeah.
I say, I'm going to start a diet on a Monday, and by Tuesday, I'm done. I mean, who else is in that boat, right? Like, we begin something and then...
Or your friend's like, oh, come on, you can start it the next day.
That's right.
Let's just go do one thing, just one thing the next day.
So true. So, Sneha, give us some tips on how can we actually set these intentions for the new year and actually make them sustainable?
Yeah. You know, I actually ask myself a very simple question. This is how I keep it within me. Again, first, I don't pick like 20 different things because that's very easy for me to do. I'll be honest. Okay. I can create that grocery list that I'm saying not to create. So I've learned from past mistakes and habits. So now I limit myself to like one or two things maximum. Like if it's like truly an intention that I want it to become a part of my being, right? It's not a task I'm just trying to check off kind of thing. I pick that one thing. And then I always just ask myself the question, like, is this going to take me closer to that thing that I've picked, or mm-hmm, is it going to take me away? If it's going to take me away, then do I need to do this? Because then it's not taking me towards where I want to be, who I want to be, what that intention is that I'm setting for myself, right? Mm-hmm. And it could be anything, like just having more patience, anything, right? Having more compassion. And then if I'm about to say something, I'm about to write a text, I'm about to whatever it may be, I ask myself, wait, is this going to take me closer to that intention of mine, or is it going to take me away? Whether it's an action, a thought, you know, anything, a writing, anything at all, is it taking me closer to who I want to be and that intention I've set for myself, or is it taking me away? I keep it that simple.
Wow. I mean, just listening to you as you were saying it, it made me think of, so it goes beyond setting the intention for the year. Mm-hmm. It's like once you have set it, it's actually everything that you're doing.
Everything.
Is that taking me that step closer, right?
That's right.
So I think that's what actually makes it work. and makes it sustainable. That's because right. It's not this just saying, I'm going to do this thing.
Yeah.
It's actually how everything else that is happening in my life, how that is influencing that intention.
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah. Like we tell our students when they're learning this concept of Dinacharya, right? Like mm-hmm. the daily routine, like we were talking about the seasonal routines, they're learning daily routines in Ayurveda. There's like 50 things you could do and you'll never do anything else the entire day. But I tell the students, like, pick one thing when they start learning it. Literally, I said, you can't. I don't even give them the option of picking more than one thing. I say, you pick one thing and you do that one thing. And then when it becomes where you're not even thinking about it, which means it's part of your being, it's part of your cellular being, then you know, okay, I can go to my second.
Mm-hmm. Yes. All right. So I'll give you 1 minute to write down, what do you think your intention is going to be? Now with all these different tools that Sneha shared with us, the seasons, the emotions, the organs, the chakras, the energy, just take 1 minute to think about what is going to be your intention and how everything around you is going to help you get closer to that. Everything that you're going to be thinking through, everything that you're going to be doing, how you can get closer to that. So take that 1 second. In the meantime, I'm going to take a look at here to see if there is any questions.
Because one thing I realize as everyone's writing that intention, whatever the intention may be, right? You have to then put it into action somehow.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I keep that question always at the top of my head, because then it helps me put everything into action versus just something I wrote on a piece of paper that maybe I'll look at, maybe I won't by the end of 2024. Who knows, right? Maybe I'll forget it halfway through.
Yeah.
But this way, if I'm able to put it into action by just asking that one question to myself, then it really becomes a part of my being.
Yes. Yeah. And it's just like that. Like first you think through it, yeah. Right? You talked about how we can rewire our brain, right?
Right.
It's like first you think about it. Second, you set the intention.
Yeah.
Third, perhaps you write it down, which is what you're doing right now. So you're already manifesting it because it's going all the way from being an idea to being actually something that you're writing down and then taking the action. So the manifestation really is the physical representation of that which you are actually taking into a place of action.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
All right. I can see here, stay with the flow. That's your intention. That's beautiful, Evelyn. Anyone else, if you want to share your intention for the year, feel free to type it. As we will continue. And again, if your intention is not coming to you right away, you know, take your time to breathe.
Yeah.
Nandini, yes. And to Sneha's point, to make sure that we connect with our breath. Also remember, our breath is the energy force. Mm-hmm. It's our prana. So making sure that we're bringing that awareness. Go to bed at an early and reasonable time.
Oh, yes.
I'll sign up for that one, too. Yes. And I think Evelyn had a question. You're raising your hand. Go
yes.
for it.
Yes. Thank you. One quick question. Do I gargle in the morning when I wake up?
Yes, ma'am. And you can gargle in the morning. You can gargle before you go to bed as well. So feel free. Anytime you feel like there's some of that congestion or anything coming up, it'll be fantastic. 2 to 3 times a day will be great for you, Evelyn.
Thank you so much. I didn't get your name because I joined late.
Oh, Sneha.
Both of your names. I'm sorry.
Sandy.
Sandy and Sneha.
Meha. Thank you very much, Sandy and Meha. Thank you.
Yes, our pleasure. All right. Now we're going to go into some of the habits or practices, if you will, that we do within Ayurveda. And these, some of them may be applicable to you. Some you may have been doing already. Some of them you would like to embed into your daily practice. Now, because we're going to be talking in February about self-love, self-healing, self-care, it's really important to talk about Dinacharya. And you just brought it up. So can you tell us what Dinacharya is?
Yeah.
And after that, let's go into like the different practices that people can do. Now, you don't have to do them all.
Right.
But walk us through it.
Yes, yes. So translated Dinacharya, like literally the word, it means like daily routine, right? But who wants routine? Just even the thought of the word routine sometimes scares people away because we want our freedom and we want our spaciousness and we don't want constriction, right? Mm-hmm. But really the purpose, if we understand what is the purpose of Dinacharya, the purpose is to set us up for the day. So what is it, that thing that you can do to set you up for your day? Is it an affirmation? Is it breath work? And these are all different types of things that we can do in our Dinacharya. There can be very classical things of Dinacharya too, like what you're saying of, you know, gargling or tongue scraping, different things like that. But if we're really talking and bringing this intention piece of my life and being more deliberate in my life, think, what is the thing that I can do in my day that is going to set me up for my day? And when I say set me up, meaning however you define a successful, joyful day for yourself, what is that thing that can help you to kickstart that day mm-hmm. so you can have that type of day for yourself?
Nice, nice. Because most of the time, what do? Right? We wake up in the morning and first thing is that alarm, beep, 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 which makes us jump off the bed, right? It's not even a pleasant thing. And then right after that, we go like, oh, it's the time. I got to make coffee or I got to take care of the kids. The dog needs to go out or the husband is hungry, right? It's like we're having to do all these things. But when do we do that self-love, self-care,
yeah.
right? So that is where Dinacharya plays a big role.
Huge.
Granted, we may need to wake up a little bit earlier, right? But if we do that, then how do we take that time to do all these different practices that allows us to actually connect with ourselves, connect with our breath, mm-hmm. and ultimately bring that nervous system down? Because even though if we were asleep,
yeah.
then also when we wake up in that accelerated speed, what happens is very likely the rest of our day will be like that.
Yes.
So if we take the time to just calm down the nervous system, give ourselves all that love that we deserve, then we can continue the rest of the day in that pace, right?
That's right.
So what are some of those yeah. practices? You mentioned the tongue scraping.
Yes.
You mentioned
The gargling. Yes.
So which are some of these other ones?
Yes. So some physical practices that we talk about in Ayurveda is the tongue scraping. Because again, the tongue is like this x-ray vision into my digestive tract. That coating that gets on the tongue is telling you how much of the toxins are building up within our system. So looking at your tongue every day when you wake up in the morning, scraping that off. So understanding what's happening internally in the mm-hmm. digestive system. Gargling, right? Cleansing out the entire throat. Even oil pulling. So first it could be with like the salt water and the turmeric, like what we've been talking about, Evelyn. You can also do oil pulling where you can get some sesame oil or coconut oil and first holding it in the mouth and then swishing it around and swishing it as long as you can, like up to 15, 20 minutes, because that is actually pulling the toxins out and then you spit it out. You don't mm-hmm. swallow that oil. Just like the gargling, you spit the gargling piece yeah. out too.
Make sure you spit it out.
Yeah. And then cleansing the eyes, right? These are all like doors of perception for our body. So then cleansing the eyes, whether it's just with some cool water, like actually splashing cool water in the eyes, or a little bit of rose water, like a couple of drops, like just cools the entire eye system down and calms that nervous system down as well.
Nice. And there is also like the dry
yes.
brushing.
Yes.
Can you talk a little bit about that for yeah. those of you that want to start adopting that?
And yeah.
Maybe the self abhyanga.
Yes. So there is, for the entire body, there is a concept of total opposites, dry brushing or actually applying warm oil to the body. And this is also part of like the self-love, right? Mm-hmm. That you're saying you're going to talk in February about.
That's right.
So it is the dry brushing and the oil massage, they both, again, help to create circulation, help to create movement, help to break up stagnation. Mm. If I have a lot of heaviness, dullness, a lot of achiness, if I feel there's some inflammation, you know, just a lot of stuckness happening, mm-hmm. the dry brushing can be a very nice one. Where you can just get a nice, sometimes now you can just go to the store and you can get these little cloths, right? That aren't like super harsh on you, but they are meant for like massaging or when you're taking a nice bath and exfoliating. So you can do a dry brushing that way. But mm-hmm. if you're an individual that's a little bit leaner that already has a lot of dryness within their body, then you don't want to add more dryness with the dry brushing. Mm-hmm. This is where you would want to do the warm oil massage instead.
Nice.
So one key principle of Ayurveda that we use is opposites balance. So if you're feeling a lot of dryness, then you want more unctuousness. If you're feeling a lot of like wetness and heaviness and dullness, then you want more lightness. So then you go towards more of that dry brushing.
Mm-hmm. Nice. And actually there is a question here from Chanda. Mm-hmm. She's asking, what type of brush do you recommend is best for the dry brushing?
So there's different types of brushes, but the simplest one I would say is you can actually go to any store that sells, you know, bath works kind of stuff. So now they have these little mittens that you can wear mm-hmm. where they're not super hard and they're meant for like exfoliating. Mm-hmm. That's a really nice way to do. So it's really simple.
Nice. And you just talked about like the opposites mm-hmm. balance. Can you also just explain to everyone like what type of oil should we use based on the time of the season? Because if it's hot outside or if it's cold, can you just talk about that a little bit?
So I love the way you're incorporating it all, Sandy. So seasons, which is what we started off talking about. So right now, depending on where you're on the world, it could be different. But like in North Carolina, Asheville area, it's cold. It warmed up a little bit this week, but it's still winter. It's still cold. And now we're getting some of that wet, damp cold, right? We had a little snow earlier in the week. Now it's a little cloudy and rainy right now too. So we're getting damp cold. Mm-hmm. So with that, then you want to see, how's your body feeling, right? Put this outside season on one side, and then how are you feeling on the other side? And then this is how we're going to determine it. Are you also feeling a lot of heaviness? Like Evelyn was saying, you're getting a lot of mucus and congestion, like that damp coldness is within your body too. If it is, then you want the exact opposite of that, right? You want a little bit more heating stuff in there. So like a sesame oil, which is considered a little bit more heating oil. So using a sesame oil to do that, like a Abhyanga or self oil massage would be good. But if you're an individual, it's cold outside, you're cold, you always find yourself putting layers on, right? It's cold. Again, you want hot at that time too. But if you're the individual where you're just constantly hot, right? You're the person that's always taking the layers off and you're like, man, why is everyone so freaking cold right now? And you're like cracking the window open, you know, that kind of thing. Exactly. And it's still winter time and the window's cracked for you. If you're that person, then you want the cooling oil, which is more of a sunflower oil or a coconut oil. These are a little bit gentler cooling oils too. Mm-hmm. And they're simple base oils. So there's nothing in it. So it's really simple for your body as well.
How amazing is that, that you can use the different types of oils depending on the time of the year mm-hmm. and how actually they help your body feel better, right? Yes. It is just about having that knowledge and then the awareness and the intentionality, because we're here to set our intention for the year, right? The intentionality of saying, okay, I know it's winter time. I'm going to go get my sesame oil and I'm going to be using my almond oil. Or in the summer, I'm going to use my coconut oil, right? Yeah. It's just like knowing that. All right.
And I'll say with everything, with the intention, with the question, like, is this serving me? Is this taking me towards my intention? Is it taking me away? And then just put in grace, right? That's something we don't do as a society. We don't do for ourselves. We have to have a little grace for ourselves, right? There is no such thing as perfection. It's okay. It is okay not to do it every single day. Just give that permission, give that grace. And that grace is actually very healing too. Because what happens when I don't give myself grace, right? Mm-hmm. I get stuck. I get stuck on judging myself, criticizing myself, and I'm just holding on to what I did wrong. Mm-hmm. That's it. Versus I have grace and that grip just loosens up a little bit. Mm-hmm. I can allow the flow to keep happening because that's what we want. We want flow. We want movement. We don't want stagnation.
Yeah, I absolutely love what you just said, because that's actually one of the reasons why most of us ended up giving up mm-hmm. our intention for the year when we actually are not graceful with ourselves, right? Because we ended up saying, let's say that eating healthy is just the intention for the year. So what happens is you go this one day that you're with your best friend and you ended up having that piece of cake. Well, then we begin with the judgment, right? And we are like, oh, I already ate this. I screw up. Let me just keep eating whatever I want, right? As opposed to just being graceful with ourselves and saying, I have the right to also enjoy life and live this moment. And it doesn't have to be 100% perfect. And just get back into that wagon. And it's okay. Just continue. As opposed to just now feeling guilty and bringing then that guilt into your liver and then having the stagnated energy and all that. So we're knowing now all the different things that we can apply in order for us to have a successful year. And granted, success for everyone looks differently.
That's right. That's right.
It's so different. Yeah. So never compare yourself to anyone and never judge yourself or where you are in your journey.
I always tell students also, it's just like 80-20 rule. 80% of the time you're doing what you want to do, right? Mm-hmm. You're setting towards your intention. You're making those choices. 20% of the time, it's okay. It's not a big deal. Yeah. You give yourself that grace.
Yeah.
80-20 rule is a very nice, comfortable, human, doable thing mm-hmm. for us on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah, for sure. Now, we're getting here towards the end, and I know that one of the things that most people like to talk about during this setting of intention is, indeed, how do I eat healthier? Mm-hmm. How do I become healthier? Because ultimately, when this human body is healthier,
yep.
our mind is healthier, our spirit is healthier. So most people look at doing some sort of cleanse or mm-hmm. detox. Mm-hmm. Can you just tell us what is the importance mm-hmm. of doing a cleanse from a mind, body, and soul point of view? And then we'll go a little bit deeper into it, but this is start there.
Definitely.
Why is it so important?
So just like what we've been talking about, throughout the year, throughout the day, throughout the seasons, stuff happens, right? Life happens. I don't always make the absolute right choices for myself. I may overeat one day. I may not eat the right food that's good for me. I may have heartburn one day. I may not release an emotion and I'm holding on to something, whatever it may be. Then it just, over time, it accumulates. It's like one little thing here, one little thing there, one little thing here, right? It just accumulates throughout the year into our body. And then all of a sudden, one day we wake up and we're like, I don't feel so good.
Mm-hmm.
I don't feel like myself. I have foggy brain. My joints hurt. My digestion's off. Oh, I can't eat these 10 foods all of a sudden that I used to eat as a child, right? All of a sudden, I can't digest something. All these things, it's an accumulated effect.
Mm-hmm.
So then the cleansing, it's so beautifully done, like in Ayurveda and the literature that's thousands of years old, the cleansing then helps us to kind of reset ourselves and say, okay, we've got all the stagnation, all this gook has built up. Let's take the gook out
mm-hmm.
and let's like restart.
Nice. And definitely, I mean, there is over 77,000 man-made toxins in the environment. For things that we eat, that we breathe, that we drink.
Yeah.
So making sure that we do actually go through that reset. And it just happens like most people ended up setting that up as their intention for the mm-hmm. year. So if that is you, just really looking into what do you need to do to reset your body. If you're feeling any stagnation, if you're feeling the fogginess or any of the symptoms that Sneha talked about, like tiredness, dry skin, you name it. Things that we think are normal. They're actually not. That's our body talking to us. So
that's
it's connecting to the body and making sure that we understand what's happening.
That's right.
So there's different ways on how people can typically do a detox mm-hmm. or a cleanse.
Yes.
And it could be joining a cleanse and doing the cleanse or doing a Panchakarma.
Yeah.
Now you're here because you've been signing up for the mailing list for Panchakarma at SoHum.
Mm-hmm.
So let's talk about the benefits of doing a Panchakarma as part of that cleanse and detoxification and resetting.
Yeah.
So how does Panchakarma help on that reset process?
So Panchakarma is a pretty intensive and deliberate process because what we're talking about, these ama, these toxins, right? The gook that builds up everywhere. It starts stagnating. It's in our lymph. It's in our blood. It's around our organs. It's in our joints. It's everywhere. So then in Panchakarma, we are consciously giving certain medicated formulations to the individual. We're loosening everything up through various therapeutic measurements too, like doing oil massages was medicated oils specific mm-hmm. for that person, herbal formulas, variety of different body work treatments. And we're moving all of that stagnation and gook, right? Or mm-hmm. ama. We're moving all of that. And then again, we give certain herbs and certain ingestions to actually purge it out of your system as well. So we're literally, Panchakarma means like five actions. We're doing all these different actions within the body and onto the body mm-hmm. to move all of the stuff out of the body. Because we don't want to just move it around and keep circulating it. Mm-hmm. Once we get it loosened up, we want to purge it out. We want to get it out of the body.
Yes. Wonderful. Thank you for sharing that. Definitely when you're thinking about the detox, there is many different versions mm-hmm. or cleanses. Just think about which one will be best for you this year, which one you want to do, mm-hmm. right? It could be one that you do at home. It could be one that you come to SoHum and do it here with us. Regardless, it's just thinking about how you bring that well-being in overall to your body.
That's right.
Now, with that, we got to the end of today's webinar, and we wanted to open it up real quick for any questions. I hope you wrote down your best tips, the ones that you found that you want to begin implementing. So does anyone have any questions for us, or do you want to share your intention? We're happy to listen to you too. Any thoughts? You can unmute yourself and talk. Go ahead, Evelyn.
I just wanted to thank both you, Meha and Sandy, for this wonderful opportunity for us to think about and work on starting 2024 the right way, the healthy way. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And our pleasure.
It's just taking a little time out, right? And yeah. consciously, again, just thinking about it. And this is a community. This is what it's about. It's just sharing and, you know, supporting each other in this process and learning from each other.
That's right. That's right. And you know that you're not alone. So you have yep. this whole full community supporting you. We get together every month. We do our talks here. So feel free to join us again next month. We're going to be talking about self-healing, self-care, and self-love. It's the month of love. And we tend to give all that love to everyone. So let's love ourselves to the max this year. Okay, let's commit to that.
So important.
Yes, it's so beautiful. And again, if you have any questions, it doesn't have to be limited to this point in time. Feel free to also email us. You can send us an email. You can reach out, give us a call. I see a comment here from Dara. Get back into the wagon. Favorite quote from Sandy. Oh my goodness. Thank you both. Your wisdom is beautiful, beautiful. Offer it, Sneha. Thank you. We love you all. And we hope you're setting up your intention for this year, whatever that intention may be.
Yes.
Big heart to you too. We love you. And we'll see you again next month. Don't miss next month, okay?
Yes.
Mwah. Thank you.